Understand the Weird SOX 5 protocol and HTTP proxy. Preface. Let's understand the SOX 5 proxy protocol together. For the convenience of understanding, we will explain the HTTP proxy protocol at the same time for comparison. First, explain the protocol and explain some common problems, and then talk about the previous application scenarios of these two protocols, as well as the current application scenarios. The content to be proxied is generally divided into TCP-based content and UDP-based content. HTTP proxy. Let's talk about HTTP proxies first. There are actually two types of HTTP proxies. One is a reverse proxy, such as Nico and Jinx, which are not shown here. The other is tunnel proxy. We mainly expand this kind of proxy. It can proxy any content based on TCP. Note that there is a misunderstanding here. Many people think that HTTP proxy can only proxy HTTP content, but it can also proxy HTTPS and any TCP-based content, but can't proxy UDP content, and we'll see why it can't proxy UDP content later. Suppose there is an HTTP proxy server. The address that a client wants to proxy. Let's assign roles. Here a client may be a Chrome browser or a curl command. The HTTP proxy server is the server. The interaction between client and server is as follows. Step 1, client-server, send the address to be proxy. Step 2, server-client, response result. Then the tunnel is established, and the client and server can transmit content to each other through this tunnel. Question 1, where is the domain name resolved? The proxy address is passed from the client to the server. If the client passes a domain name address, the domain name will be resolved on the server. Of course, it is also possible that the client pre-resolves the IP of the domain name locally, and then passes it to the server IP address. So where the domain name is resolved depends entirely on the role of the client that initiated the request in the first place. Question 2, cannot proxy UDP content. As seen in the interaction steps, the entire interaction does not distinguish between TCP or UDP fields, right? So it can only proxy TCP content. Of course, some students will say that to force the server to treat it as UDP content, then it will actually become another proxy protocol. Question 3, the transmission content is not encrypted. This is actually relative to the HTTP proxy server, which receives the content without secondary processing. Of course, if the content of the proxy requested by the client is HTTPS content, the content has been encrypted by TLS on the client side, so once again, this is actually relative to HTTP proxy server, that is, HTTP proxy is a non-encrypted proxy protocol. SOX 5 proxy. Let's talk about the SOX 5 proxy again. It can proxy any TCP-based content, as well as UDP content. But in fact, many SOX 5 proxy servers do not implement UDP support. You can use the Vbrook test SOX 5 command to test whether a SOX 5 server supports UDP. Suppose there is a SOX 5 server. The TCP address that a client wants to proxy. Let's assign roles. Here, a client may be a Chrome browser, a curl command, or a game client. The SOX 5 server is the server. The interaction between the client and the server is as follows. For the convenience of understanding, the original protocol is abstracted into human-readable content. Step 1, client-server, TCP, ask the protocol version and authentication method. Step 2, server-client and TCP, response protocol version and authentication method. Step 3, client-server, TCP, if the server needs authentication, send the authentication information. Step 4, server-client and TCP, if the server needs authentication, respond to the authentication result. Step 5, client-server, TCP, send the address to be proxied. Step 6, server-client and TCP, response result. Then the tunnel is established, and the client and server can transmit content to each other through this tunnel. We noticed that the whole process between the client and the server is the TCP protocol. The UDP address a client wants to proxy. The interaction between the client and the server is as follows, and for the convenience of understanding, the original protocol is abstracted into human-readable content. Step 1, client-server (TCP), ask the protocol version and authentication method. Step 2, server-client and TCP, response protocol version and authentication method. Step 3, client-server (TCP), if the server needs authentication, send the authentication information. Step 4, server-client and TCP, if the server needs authentication, respond to the authentication result. Step 5, the client, prepare a SRC address, which will be used to interact with the server through UDP. Step 6, client-server, TCP, tell the server that you want to use SRC for UDP communication. Step 7, the server, prepare a DST address, which will be used to receive the UDP data sent by the client. Note, our SOX 5 server address is this, but the UDP server prepared by the server may not be this, but any address, such as this, or even something else a server on other machine, such as this. Step 8, server-client and TCP, tell the client that it can send UDP data to the DST address. Step 9, client SRC-server DST UDP, start proxying UDP data. Then the UDP tunnel is established, and the client and server can transmit UDP content to each other through this tunnel. Question 1, where is the domain name resolved? The proxy address is passed from the client to the server. If the client passes a domain name address, the domain name will be resolved on the server. Of course, it is also possible that the client pre-resolves the IP of the domain name locally, and then passes it to the server IP address. So where the domain name is resolved depends entirely on the role of the client that initiated the request in the first place. Question 2, UDP can be proxied, but TCP is still used in the previous communication. That is to say, SOX 5 can proxy UDP, but before starting to proxy UDP, it still needs to conduct a series of communication through TCP. Question 3, when proxying UDP, it may be necessary to keep the TCP connection uninterrupted. We know earlier that in order to proxy UDP, a TCP connection must be established for a series of communications. According to the standard protocol description, during proxy UDP, this pre-communicated TCP connection can be divided into two situations. One is to disconnect after the communication. One is to stay connected after the communication. The server can decide whether to allow or deny proxy UDP based on whether the TCP connection is disconnected or not. So if the client and server do not communicate in advance, the client should maintain this TCP connection without disconnecting. Question 4, can I use Brook Relay to relay SOX 5 server? We know that a Brook Relay, you can use the SOX 5 server IP parameter to specify the IP of the UDP server. Question 5, the transmission content is not encrypted. This is actually relative to SOX 5 server, which does not have secondary processing after receiving the content. Of course, if the content of the proxy requested by the client is HTTPS content, the content has been encrypted by TLS on the client side, so once again, this is actually relative to the SOX 5 server, that is, the SOX 5 proxy is a non-encrypted proxy protocol. Question 6, how should we view the standards of the protocol? It can take a long time for an protocol to go from draft to standard, and adherence to standards can also be beneficial in reducing discrepancies and fragmentation. Question 7, NAT type. When it comes to UDP proxy, the NAT type is generally considered. We know that there are four NAT types, full cone NAT, address restricted cone NAT, port restricted cone NAT, and symmetric NAT. Symmetric is the most secure type, so Brook, by yourself. HTTP proxy and SOX 5 proxy usage scenarios. A long time ago, the internet did not pay much attention to encryption. At that time, everyone built an HTTP proxy or SOX 5 proxy at the remote end, and then configured the remote proxy address on the local application, and it was used happily. However, one day, people woke up, and the data I sent to the remote end through these two proxy protocols was not encrypted, so that people on the road could see the data I transmitted. It's a little unhappy. So for example, the Jabrook, protocol with strong encryption and undetectable protocol was born. Because of the development in ancient times, many applications such as Chrome browser support the configuration of SOX 5 server, so the proxy mode like Brook client will create a local SOX 5 server, which also means that the usage scenarios of HTTP proxy and SOX 5 proxy basically transition from the previous remote mode to local mode. Scope of HTTP proxy and SOX 5 proxy. Earlier we mentioned that these two protocols have transitioned from remote mode to local mode. No matter where they are running, their roles are servers, and whether they use this proxy as a client role depends entirely on the client role. For example, if the system proxy is configured, Chrome will go through the proxy, but the terminal will not go through the proxy. I encourage everyone to switch to the M1 version of Mac, which is also a trend. You can use the iOS version of Brook client. Mobile client is in virtual network card mode by default, not in proxy mode. Similarly, the mobile phone is the same. You have configured the system proxy on the mobile phone, but the app, as the client role, can choose whether to use the proxy.